Hey, what's up, y'all? Welcome back. Welcome back. The Airgun Experience. This is a great little podcast we've been doing. It's all about the Airgun Experience. We're bringing on guests and talking about them from everything from Airguns, but then just life in general and trying to figure out how they got to become who they are now. We got a fun little show today. As usual, I'm joined by Abby Casey.
What's up, guys?
AC Outdoors. You can find all of her wonderful videos,
yeah,
pictures.
All kinds of stuff.
Yeah, she's always in a swimsuit, so check it out. She's a lady of Instagram. It's not true. It's not true.
Yeah.
And of course, from Utah Airguns, Justin Jacobson.
Hey, everybody.
How you doing, man?
Doing well.
You okay? It's a crazy weekend.
Crazy week this week with RMAC, but no, I'm good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's a lot. There's like 50,000 airgun shooters in your store right now, and you're just up here with us.
What better place to be, right?
I couldn't agree more. Now today, we have a fun, exciting guest. We had a chance to grab him. I mean, he's a difficult man to get, only because he's from South Africa. He's not in the States that much. And when he is around, he is hopping around like a crazy person, hunting, shooting, filming, selling his scopes, the man from, gosh, he's got a lot going on, and we're going to talk about that. But we are joined today by Matt Dubber. Maddie, how you doing, buddy?
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's a great opportunity and doing very well, actually. I normally come over here like just before the competition or just before I need to do something, and it's like trying to get over a 10-hour time difference and like trying to get my gun sorted, and this year I decided to come out a week early and acclimatize and get everything done early, and it's been a really great decision because I can just kind of chill out now and hang out with people and catch up, and I don't have to stress about the small things.
Yeah, and I mean, and usually when you're here and you're really stressed out and then you just win all the time, like I understand like how difficult that is to overcome and get everything. It seems to work out for
it's
you, though.
It's a roller coaster ride. Yeah, it's a roller coaster ride, but I feel like I'm a bit more relaxed this year and just trying to soak it all in after 3 years of not being able to come over.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about it. I mean, last year, that was kind of the excitement, right? Matt Dubber wasn't here. Someone else is going to win. Let's talk about pedigree. Just RMAC. I mean, forget about all the other competitions. Just RMAC. What have you done in the few years that you have been able to make RMAC? What have you won? Where have you placed? And what have you enjoyed the most?
Well, I've enjoyed everything. The one event I don't often compete in is the big ball, just because we have pretty intense caliber restrictions in South Africa,
right?
And it's just quite a big adjustment to have to get a big bore gun set up, and just it's just a lot of work to do that. So my focus has always been sort of the I think the speed and the precision rifles kind of my strength, and then the big bore
kind of
very modest,
and then the bench rest is something I've got a little bit of experience with, having competed at, you know, other events in the past and RMAC and everything.
Sure.
But yeah, so the first year I came here, I took first in the precision rifle, and I think second or third in the speed. And then the second year I came, which was 2019.
Yeah.
I took first precision rifle, first in speed, and third in the bench rest.
Awesome.
So that was a really good year for me. And let me just make it clear, I'm not expecting to do anywhere close to that this year, because this sport is growing so quickly that everyone's eyes are on the sport. And you've got guys who are like super experienced precision rifle or in a role shooters coming here and with way more experience with me as me. And I feel like I had my time when it was relatively small to kind of do well, but now it's like I've kind of proven myself, I don't need to feel the pressure, and I'm just here to enjoy it.
Sure. Time will tell, my friend. Time will tell. There
is humble, but I wouldn't count him out of any of those events.
And there's an epic we're gonna link to this. There's an epic American Airgunner episode that shows his walk, or kind of the whole trajectory from the first couple of days of RMAC through that speed competition win, and it is epic. It's so dramatic. It like came crazy down. They split, and it came. So oh my gosh, it was unbelievable. Of all the competitions we've shot and tried, we try to time that up. You know, you're guessing who's going to be there. You do some interviews. We followed Matt. We'd had some experience with extreme bench press in the past, and you kind of getting there. And you're always a good interview. And I always love Matt right before. I'm like, hey, Matt, can I? He's like, no, not right before. Never right before. But you gave us the time that time, and you did all the interviews following up, and it was just, it could not have gone better.
I'm glad I allowed you to follow me around, because I so enjoyed watching that episode back. And just remembering what
yeah. it was like. Because we caught some serious emotion. Yeah. Like before, you had just almost gotten beat at the end, and then there was a disqualification or something with Tomcat, right? He had shot too many times.
There was I believe it was Derek Wall had a negligent shot before the timer, and was up.
There was so much that happened, and then you guys splitting that. Best out of three, and the last one was like kink kink.
And John's such a good shooter.
Yeah. And then John comes back and wins last year. So I'm just saying this year could be good.
Like Jaden Tucker, is it?
Yeah, Jaden's really fast.
Really fast.
Jaden is.
So it's gonna be interesting.
Yeah.
But
can't wait.
Yeah, I feel like I try not to think about it. Because I know very well what first place prizes are, but I don't want to look at anything because I don't want to get in my head. I just want to come and enjoy it, and whatever happens, happens.
You're a veteran now.
I'm just thinking of Anchorman, where he's like, hey, come do a jazz flute solo. He's like, oh, I'm not prepared. And you pull the flute
off. Yeah, all right.
That's how I feel. Like, I try to not put pressure on myself, but somewhere in my sleeve is something all the time. And
well, so,
yeah. But your poise, though, during competition is solid. Like you don't. A lot of people really lock up in that moment, or have the tendency to do so, which is human nature.
Yeah,
and you got ice in your veins though when you're up on the line. That's. I was nervous for you.
Yeah.
At that, when you won that speed competition, and just like the intensity, and there was a great pitcher that got snapped at one point during that speed, and there's like. Media people circling you, like somebody snapped a perfect picture. There's just cameras all around it, and you know, you guys both, you know, you and John both, I mean, stayed pretty solid. But
I think John is more used to the competition environment. I'm not, but I'm used to having like cameras on me and attention. But also, I feel like I don't need to prove myself. Like I would hope that people don't value me or look up to me just because I'm a good shooter. I would hope that it's more than that. So my philosophy is like, I'm going to do my best, but if I bomb out, it's not the end of the world. Like this sport is about having fun and about seeing people and the camaraderie. So I feel like my priorities are straight, and I think that helps me a lot. Like I don't place my whole value on where I come in a competition.
You can't come into any competition and have expectations, because expectations are the death of anything when you go into a match. It overrides like any kind of straight thinking you've got going on. Yeah. Expectations kill it.
Agreed.
Just to ease your mind too, I think everybody looks up to you for a lot more reasons than competition.
Yeah it's clearly your man. It's clearly your man bun.
It is a man bun. Is it a
for a man under 30 years old? Yeah. And he's done so much and he knows so much. And I'm like, I don't know how you come up with all this knowledge already at your age. You're very
well. It's been my full time job since high school. So
okay, well then
you've been in it longer than I have. Hell,
I guess if you've been doing it.
It's the beard, the man bun, and the flip flops. I mean, that's really where people dial in, right?
Probably.
All right, let's get outside of Airguns. What's going on in life? How are you? What's happening? What are you working on? What are you passionate about? Let's get to it.
I'd say a lot has changed since I was at the last RMAC. That was 2019 before the COVID stuff. Like back then, I wasn't married. Now I am. Mm-hmm. It was a big adjustment.
Congratulations.
That's great that Nicole's able to basically come with me on all my trips, and she helps to film, and we go camping together and shooting together.
It looks like you guys are having like the best time.
So that's been really great.
Yeah.
The other big thing is Element Optics. So it was in the works already in 2019, but obviously we couldn't show anything. But 2020 came along, great time for a lot of business. we launched Element Optics. It was myself, Ted Beer, Shane Keller,
and Johan Axelsson, and that's just that. Honestly, that's been my my main focus the last few years. Like, we've put so much time and energy into that. I still love the YouTube thing, and I really enjoy doing it. But for me, it's like the pressure of making YouTube a job is gone, mm-hmm. and I can just enjoy it now. And my focus, like I'm really focused on making the best scopes possible, and really enjoy working with those guys. Like I genuinely don't think we've ever had an argument, which is amazing. Like we all work together so well, and it's been a really fun journey.
That's awesome.
So yeah, so there's a lot going on.
Let's dive into that a little bit. What separates Element scopes from the other billions of scopes out there? What's the focus?
So I think the focus for us is, you know, let's say a customer comes to a store and they've got a certain budget and they want to buy a precision rifle scope or a scope for any sort of precision shooting. What are your priorities in terms of the features? A lot of people look at, you know, the weight and the length and stuff for hunting, or the optical quality, which is obviously important in any scope, but there has to be a foundation. A lot of people don't realize how important some of the internal components and mechanics and the way things fit together, and the materials and the tolerances and the quality inspections. And a lot of people will never even pick up those small details because they're so fine. And a lot of people don't have the equipment to even see how well their scope performs in terms of tracking and is there a shift when you parallax the scope and mm-hmm. all these things. And so our approach was always, okay, we've got a certain budget. Let's build it from the ground up. Let's make sure that we've got the best possible materials to build something that's bulletproof mm-hmm. and tracks perfectly, because you can't call it a precision scope if it's not precise. Oh, it's not just about
fair.
It's got to track perfectly. If it doesn't track perfectly, it's not a precision rifle scope. Even if it's a budget precision rifle scope, it's that has to be the foundation. Mm. And stuff like light transmission and optical performance, yes, that's important, but that has to come afterwards. So that's been our focus. And I think what separates us as people is that all of us are very involved with in the public eye and with shooting. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have to use these products. So if we rock up with something that we don't trust or we don't believe in or something that doesn't work, we're going to be miserable.
Sure.
I mean, in the past, I've come to RMAC and, you know, been sponsored by Nightforce and other optics companies who make great scopes, by the way. But for me to put those aside and pick up something else, it's got to be good. Like, I'm not going to sacrifice anything when everyone's watching me. And that's,
sure.
I think that's, if anyone wants to know why can you trust the brand, I'd say because we are comfortable using this.
The fact that top shooters are setting aside very expensive, very known scopes to yeah. use these says a lot about the quality and
yeah.
that it's precise.
Yeah.
Love it, man. I want to, just for people out there that don't know, when you talk about stuff like tracking and light transmission, mm-hmm. like what is that? What is tracking when you said it to, so people out there, they're like, I know scopes, I look through, I see the reticle, I yeah. sight it in, it is what it is. What does a precision rifle scope need to be?
Well, I'd say sort of a hunting rifle scope where it's sort of the classic, you have cap turrets and you zero it and then you don't touch them. Mm-hmm. With that, the main thing is that it doesn't shift zero, but the actual tracking performance, in other words, if you dial a certain number of clicks, is the reticle moving that same amount of clicks? Mm-hmm. It's a whole different discipline. And for those sort of disciplines, that stuff doesn't matter as much. But if you are, I mean, let's talk airgun specifically, with any of these competitions, you're not just shooting at the distance you zeroed at, you're shooting further, which means that your pellet's going to drop or your slug's going to drop. You have to either hold with a reticle or dial for it. Mm-hmm. If you're holding with a reticle, then your reticle has to be perfectly calibrated. If it's 5% off, in other words, the scale of the etching on the glass doesn't match up with what it's supposed to match up on your target, then your slug or pellet's going to impact a different place to where you want it to impact. And that's completely useless. It's not a usable reticle. You've got to then change the calibration on your on your ballistics app for that reticle, and most people don't have the means to do that. So that makes the reticle almost useless. So reticle calibration is a big thing. But then as far as the tracking performance of the turrets go, basically how it works is you've got elevation and windage turrets, which move a post up and down and push against an erector tube, which moves up and down. And the thread pitch of that turret determines, you know, if you're turning a certain number of clicks, how much that post is pushing against the erector tube and how much it's moving. And if that's not calibrated correctly, and let's say you have a 3 or 4% error, which a lot of not even budget, but like mid-range scopes do,
yeah,
then it's the same thing. You dial a certain number of mils or MOA and something's wrong. Like your trajectory is not matching up to what it should be. So,
and the format for the competitions these days, firearms or air guns, you're shooting at small targets at long distance.
Yeah.
So if the scope doesn't track correctly, you miss.
Right.
And
it's always been my scope or the wind or the pellet.
No, it happens, right?
Yeah. And, you know, back in the day, you just think 10, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, before laser rangefinders were a thing and like easily available and affordable and good, you go out there with a hunting rifle, you kind of want to limit your range quite severely to make sure you can put in an ethical shot.
Mm.
And so a reliable turret's not that important because you don't have a reliable range to feed into your system. So then you're relying more on your skill as a hunter to get close, or you're relying on a flat shooting rifle to kind of make your margin for error a bit less.
Sure.
But nowadays, where you can get very precise ranges, and we've got sort of disciplines that are popping up, like precision rifle and NRL and everything, just allowing for you to test your skills at all these different ranges, that suddenly that technical performance becomes so much more important. So times are changing and you have to move forward with them.
And you love this stuff, don't you? I mean, like, you love to geek out on air guns and scopes and whatever.
Yeah.
Have you always been like that? Like how'd you get into this stuff? What were you doing before you were diving into the internal parts of air guns?
So I actually, when I was growing up, I've always been interested in guns. I mean, when I was just small enough to like eat a piece of bread, I would chew the bread into a shape of a pistol. And my parents actually, they went to talk to psychologists. They're like, hey, should we be taking this? Should we be like reprimanding him for this? Because what if he turns into like this gun crazy killer?
Yeah.
And they were like, don't worry about it. But I grew up with guns. I loved it. I had a passion for building model rockets.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd build a rocket. I'd build like nose cone designs on CAD programs to see what's the most aerodynamic shape and how to get materials light and
you know, rocket kid stuff.
Had no interest in school, which was a problem because I wanted to be an aeronautical engineer.
Uh-huh.
And when my marks weren't good enough to study aeronautical engineering, I was like, what else can I do with my time? And I actually stumbled upon Ted Beer's videos from Ted's Holdover.
Yeah.
And I just remember the day that I realized that an air gun, I saw a video of someone hunting a rabbit or a pigeon. It was like, you can shoot a rabbit or a pigeon with an air gun and it can be ethical. Because I grew up with very, very cheap like break barrels and daisies and
inaccurate
stuff.
Yeah.
And this world of precision air rifle shooting just opened up to me. And I looked at Ted's video and I thought, hey, like, I'm sure I could do this. I've played around with some editing, like, let me try. And I started my channel and it was terrible at the beginning, but a few years later it started really growing. And you know, it's just provided opportunities for me to meet the right people and get involved in the industry, and there's been no looking back. I've really enjoyed it.
And that channel, what is that channel?
So that channel is called Air Arms Hunting SA.
Yeah.
I know my accent makes it sound, but it's Air Arms.
Air Arms.
Yeah. It's pretty explanatory. I hunt in South Africa.
Yeah.
Do some tutorial videos and reviews as well, but I really enjoy sort of just getting out to the middle of nowhere and hunting.
And then you've got another channel, other channels. You got the Oxwagon Diaries.
So that's a series within my Air Arms Hunting SA channel, Oxwagon Diaries, but that's
okay.
That's the main series that everyone really enjoys. It's
right.
Just like,
and what are you doing on that?
Place. So that series, it's a trying to convert to acres. I'm not sure it is in acres, but it's 50,000 hectares. So it's a very big property, private land. It's a big conservancy. And there's old ox wagons, which are like, you know, the ox-drawn carriages that you guys tracked out west with here. It's the same thing. And they're a few hundred years old and they've been refurbished and you basically go camp inside them. And the property owner's just like, hey, you know, you're welcome to go out and shoot whatever. And that's become this thing where every time I meet someone anywhere in the world, they're like, hey, you're the guy from the Oxford who shoots the monkeys.
Yeah.
It's like this.
Monkey man. Yeah. I mean, yeah, but you got, it's a different world out down there in South Africa. You got to hunt where you've got the pests. You hunt the pests.
Yeah.
That's the goal.
Yeah. It's different, but it's also, I can so relate. Even just being out here this morning, I looked outside. I'm like, hey, this kind of looks like South Africa, like mountains and a little bit dry. And the animals are very different, but I think the whole culture is quite similar. Like, I just feel like I can relate to you guys so easily. And there's such a strong connection there with all the similar interests and I think similar values, similar lifestyles, like just love for the outdoors and
sure.
love to just that rush when you pull the trigger. It's pretty addictive.
I agree. So,
yeah.
I agree.
What do you do when you're not hunting or shooting or building scopes?
So
outside of a racket. Yeah, rockets.
Rocket building.
Yeah. So I'm actually, I really enjoy just climbing in my truck and driving to very remote places with Nicole, who's my wife, and just pulling up somewhere and just camping for a few days and just disconnecting. And we've got all these lists of these incredible places in Africa that we've wanted to see. And we've kind of kitted out our vehicle to the point where we can be relatively comfortable. Like I've got a hot geyser. I can take hot showers every night. Mm. I've got a fridge and freezer and like everything there. I've got a compressor wired up so I can fill my air tanks if I want to hunt or whatever.
Sure.
But it's just this feeling of like, hey, I can get out of my house at any moment, go somewhere very remote and just experience a different landscape. So I'd say that's probably my biggest, that's been taking up all my time lately, outside of the shooting stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I also really enjoy, like, I play guitar and drums and I enjoy music, but I just have no time for that.
Sure.
So, but you started another YouTube channel.
Yeah.
So more about your adventures.
Yeah. It actually started a long time back. Just Matt Dubber. Channel's called Matt Dubber.
Yeah.
I think I'm on like 20,000 subscribers now. So it's been growing steadily. I've been putting a bit more energy into it lately, but that's more of like a travel channel. So if I go to, I don't know, I did some vlogs in Utah last time I was here and done a lot of travel in Japan and Europe.
Yeah, so weren't you in Germany or something recently?
Yeah, I went to Germany, Austria, Netherlands.
Yeah.
Like whenever it was cancelled, I was like, hey, well, like flights booked, might as well just go.
Right.
Almost got trapped there with COVID, couldn't get home.
Oh, jeez.
But it was all part of fun.
Yeah.
Share the channel with everybody so they know.
Yeah, the channel's just called Matt Dubber.
Yeah, on YouTube. And
on YouTube.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're doing a lot, man. I just have to make this. We have two newlyweds here on this podcast. Newlywed.
Thank you. You too.
So very excited. I got cats during COVID. Justin, what about you?
I got rid of some cats.
Okay, weird. That got awkward.
You know what? Not good cats.
Right. Right.
Not bad.
That's we're gonna move off of that.
Abby in her spare time did wood carving. I would point that out.
Yeah, Abby does wood carving. So here I'm curious, who cooks? You or your wife?
We kind of take turns.
Who cooks?
I'm the cook.
Who does the dishes?
The dishwasher does the dishes.
Who loads it?
Not me.
We don't have a dishwasher, so we are the dishwasher.
I'll say this. I trust myself with cooking a lot more than I trust Nicole.
Okay.
She does make great food. She does make great food, but I consider myself a meat connoisseur. I love, I just love meat so much.
Okay.
I don't like
it. I mean, the grilling, I always keep the grilling. Like, my wife does a lot of cooking. She's basically a chef. But anytime it comes to grilling, I'm like,
I got this.
I got this.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I don't think she'd need me for anything.
We just recently started building an Overlander as well. Oh, yeah. I don't know if you saw it, the parking lot. We got a big tent on it and all that stuff.
Is it the hard shell rooftop tent?
Yes, the DFC.
Yeah.
Go fast campers.
Nice. Is that with the RSI canopy?
That doesn't have the canopy on it.
Okay.
But they do make a solid shell that opens up all on the sides that is integrated into the tent. And then they make a, just the tent separate. So you could have either or.
Nice.
Maybe we should do another. We'll do a full show on a double date with Matt and his wife and Abby and her husband. Yeah. They'll get together, they'll jump in their cars and drive to where no one else can find them. It's a great double date.
Come to Africa, the best trip ever is to come, go from South Africa. You go up through Namibia, through the beautiful, the biggest sand dunes in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Just beautiful.
We haven't had our honeymoon yet.
And then you go through what's called the Caprivi Strip, which is just some of the densest, like just hippos, elephants, just the big five everywhere. Very
sounds dangerous.
It's very it's dangerous. I mean, you're camping with the lions, basically.
Yeah, cool. I'll be on top of the roof, though.
Yeah, you must. You have to.
You must.
Yes. Yeah, and then Victoria Falls.
Okay.
And then you come down through Botswana, all the way down to South Africa again. It's just you need a solid 2 or 3 weeks for that.
Uh-huh.
But it's. It'll be the most incredible experience.
That sounds epic. Yeah. I'm guessing you've done it a few times.
I actually haven't, but
you haven't?
I've done bits of it.
Yeah.
But I'm planning sometime later this year to just take. I need to find time. It's probably, but just
take.
Yeah,
like one of those once in a lifetime things.
How do you? Okay, you're camping out there with the lions, and you're on top of the tent. Is it kind of like out here we have grizzlies and we have black bears? Is it the same similar technique where you don't have food laying around, or what can you do? Yeah.
I mean, I say the biggest problem with food is like monkeys and baboons.
Yeah.
Like because they can open your car door.
And it always comes back to monkeys.
They can open your door. They can open zips on your tent.
What?
Like there's nothing. You have to put locks on everything, and you have to lock your car. Otherwise, they'll.
Have you put a razor wire around your car? Why?
That's not a bad idea, but it's not frowned upon.
The monkeys.
Especially when you need to go to the bathroom tonight. Yeah. But the lions are, it's not fun to camp at night, and you hear, it makes your blood curdle.
Like a lion roar?
Yeah, that would be
just a
grunting kind of like.
Grunt.
Oh my gosh.
I've heard them on Nat Geo doing that. It's terrifying.
Yeah, there's some funny videos on YouTube of guy, like a guy in a ground tent, like terrified out of his mind, and this lion like trying to figure out how to get in.
That's why you camp on top of your car.
Yeah.
There you go.
How do you protect yourself though from that? I mean, are you allowed to carry a pistol in Africa?
Well, not in those areas are very protected because of poaching.
Yeah.
You can't carry any firearms in there.
So what about like pepper spray or? Is that
that's not good. That's not going to be.
Because we have bear spray. We have bear spray here.
Yes. Mark your territory.
Yeah. I think you just have to.
Don't get
them. They're not there necessarily to eat you. They're just there because they're curious. So you just have to.
Wait it out.
Wait it out.
I think it's a safe rule that when the lions come in, keep your pants on. I think that's something we should probably. Alert the masses.
Sound advice from Rossi, right?
All right, that is it. I'm sure we could talk to Mr. Dubber forever. The guy's got so much going on, doing so many great things in the airgun world, in the firearms world, YouTube, scopes. He's got it all going. You can find him at Airarms Hunting SA.
Yep.
And Matt Dubber on YouTube. And then, of course, all the matching social medias as well.
Yeah, Matt Dubber on Instagram.
All right, and we'll put links, of course, below. Matt, dude, thanks for being here. We appreciate it.
I enjoyed it.
Thanks for joining the Airgun Experience.
Yeah.